I am Ron Beal, a professor at Baylor Law School, and it is indeed my privilege to introduce to you Chief Justice Wallace B. Jefferson of the Texas Supreme Court. Justice Jefferson graduated from the University of Texas School of Law in 1988. After graduation, he moved to San Antonio and specialized in appellate practice. During those years, he had two cases before the United States Supreme Court that he was successful with, as well as appearing often at the Fifth Circuit, the Texas Supreme Court, and other courts of appeals. In 2001, Chief Justice Jefferson was appointed to the Supreme Court by Governor Rick Perry. In 2002, he resoundingly was reelected. In 2004, he was appointed Chief Justice. And in 2008, once again, he was resoundingly reelected to office. Welcome.
Thank you. Good to be here.
Well, today I'd like, if you will allow me, to probe your mind regarding appellate practice. And I guess being the good professor, I'll start with citing to just one rule that says, in the appellate rules of procedure, that 53.1 provides that the lawyer's vehicle to request your court to grant a right of petition, as we all know, is a petition for review. And under Rule 53, it states that the lawyer shall set forth a summary of the argument in a succinct, clear, and accurate statement, and that the argument itself should be clear and concise. And my question to you is, does the court mean that, and are the lawyers mostly complying with that?
The lawyers are complying, which is a good thing, because you have to look at it from the perspective of the judge. It used to be that on the Supreme Court of Texas, you would come to the court with an application for writ of error, and that was a 50-page work with everything included, every argument to the detail, and most lawyers would take up all 50 pages. In the late 1990s, the court transitioned into a petition for review process. Mm-hmm. And the thought was that the judge would more likely read the petition from cover to cover. Under the application for writ of error process, law clerks would read those applications and summarize what they said and present in a memo and sometimes in oral fashion the petition to the court for a decision on whether to grant or not. When we went to the 15-page procedure, now the judge gets a box of petitions every week, and we go through those petitions and read them and decide whether or not we would want to discuss this. Now, I've brought with me a prop, just to give you an idea of what happens.
Okay.
Along with the box of petitions, there might be 17 to 25 petitions in a box. We get what's called a purple sheet. And on this purple sheet, each one of these cause numbers represents a petition for review. And so I have this box by my desk, and I will go chronologically from the earlier cause number to the latest, pull out the petition and put it on my desk and begin to read. Now, I might do this at home. I might do this on the road, but I do this myself. And most of the other judges do, not all. Some have law clerks reviewing them. So what I'm looking for when I begin the process is a quick conceptualization of what the major issues are. And I know that when I begin the process, I've got many more afterwards. Mm-hmm. So it's a relatively quick read. And as I'm reading it, I'm looking at, there are several things that I can do, and each judge has one of these. You can mark it to, you can say, first of all, you're not sitting at all because my brother is involved in the case. Or you might decide it's clearly a deny. It's an interlocutory matter, or they're looking at asking us to review the factual sufficiency of whatever happened below, and those are things that we don't do on the court. So it might be dismissal for want of jurisdiction or an outright deny because the Court of Appeals got it right. But if you vote to discuss, the lawyers out there ought to know, if any single judge votes to discuss that petition, it's going to be brought to a later conference. So I'm going through these, and I'm quickly. It's 15 pages, which is about the right length, and I need a very quick summary of what the case is about and why it's important to the jurisprudence. And you can do that in 15 pages. We don't make you go through an entire brief on the merits at this stage. What you're trying to do is capture the judge's attention. And if you do it right, it is a pretty quick read. Now, if you do it wrong, if I'm reading through the petition and I can't figure out what you're saying, or it's too complex for me to put my mind around, or it's confusing or not well written, the first thing I'm going to do is stop reading that petition and go to the Court of Appeals opinion. Because generally they are very good at encapsulating the opinion right at the beginning and right throughout the opinion. That's not what you want, because you're complaining about the Court of Appeals opinion. You'd rather have it, you know, come from your own words. So you need to write it in a way that will capture my attention and put it very clearly what you are asking the court to do. Now, if I can tell you one more thing that I do as I'm reading these.
Sure.
And that is, I am projecting the future of your case. So if this is a case that I'm interested, or if it's one that I think one of my colleagues will be interested in, I'm taking notes. And maybe I'm formulating an opinion as I'm reading through the petition. And the notes I'm taking are, you know, for myself. What is the case about? What happened at the trial court level and the Court of Appeals level? What is it that you find to be wrong and important about the case? And what relief are you seeking? Those are the sorts of things that are going through my mind. Now, I've been doing this long enough, it's been 9 years now, it's hard to believe, that I have an idea of what my colleagues may be thinking. And I might even project that I'm going to be on the other side of their thinking on this case. I may disagree with where they're going to come, because I've seen similar cases and I know what the other judges are thinking. So as I'm taking notes, I'm beginning my process of being an advocate on the Supreme Court. To say why the case should not be granted, or why it should be granted, and if it is granted, what the result ought to be. I mean, this is in a very short period of time. I'm taking these notes to remind me when it comes up for conference what my thinking was when I read the petition, and then when I come to conference, I have written these notes down. Usually, I've typed them on the computer, so there'll be usually not more than this space right here, the bottom of this space. I'll bring this sheet where my notes are kept, and it gives my summary of the case. So I, from your petition, I have distilled it even further, and I'm ready. You know, theoretically, I'm ready for any argument that will come from another judge. We do this on paper. If I'm traveling, I'll write it by hand, but more likely, all these are electronic now. It didn't used to be that way when I came to the court. Everything you had to handwrite and circulate paper. But now the voting sheets are all online. So as I'm summarizing, the rest of the court doesn't have access to my own thoughts, but they will have my vote, and I can see where everyone else's vote is before I walk into conference.
Well, that is so excellent, and you've made it so transparent. Can I just ask one question?
Sure.
Is that if everyone says not discuss, and is that the end of that case? I mean, not necessarily lack of jurisdiction or improper appeal, but if we just all say, don't check that box.
Yes, there will be, again, electronically, we'll get, I guess it's about a week after the votes are due for this one box of petitions.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get a set of, it's on a green sheet that Nadine Schneider, our administrator, will circulate. And she'll show where all the votes came down. And if in the, close to the last column, all the votes are to deny, I don't have to look at it again, and the court doesn't have to unless there's a motion for rehearing. It's denied.
Okay.
If for some reason, and this doesn't occur often, but if for some reason a judge does not vote at all on the petition, say on this first petition,
mm-hmm.
if a judge just neglects to vote on it, the default is to deny.
To deny.
So these petitions are on a conveyor belt headed to the trash bin unless a judge decides that there's something of interest that they would like to discuss.
Excellent. So in that light, you know, there's rule, I think it's 56, that sets forth your court's jurisdiction. How important is it in these 15 pages for the scrivener to directly reference one or more of those bases to establish jurisdiction? Or can they merely assert their substantive argument and understand or think that you'll know that fits one of those?
I would, if I were them, lay out the provision that they are asserting gives the court jurisdiction, and then say why.
Okay.
A very common assertion for jurisdiction is a conflict among the courts of appeals. So under section 22.006, whatever, you know, conflict provision that is, subsection, I would say that there's a conflict among the courts of appeals. Court A has held this way. This court has held directly opposite. That's a conflict. It would help to show that there are other, you know, other courts that are addressing this as well, so that there's a real need for uniformity in the rule of law that is at issue in the case. So I would lay that out. Or there's a constitutional provision at stake, or there's a dissent in the Court of Appeals. You don't have to go on at length, but as you're doing that, say why it's important to resolve the conflict. I mean, there are some conflicts, you know, I mean, really, how important is it to the jurisprudence of the state,
right,
on some minor area of, say, minor rule, that is never likely to come up again? I mean, do we may want to take it, and some judges would, but some would say that's not really important, and the case is not that grave for citizens of Texas, so we can let that go. If it manages to come up again, then maybe we'll take it on then. So not only say there's a conflict or this is statutory interpretation, but why is it important for us, the court, to take it, and why now? Why not wait? You know, why should we take it now rather than wait until the law is developed over the coming months and years? Sometimes the statute is old. It's been repealed. It's never going to come up again. So why do we take this one? You know, maybe, you know, we're thinking this is not going to happen ever again in the history of Texas. So why do we need to resolve it? Well, maybe there's gross unfairness. Or maybe the kind of statute that was being considered before, even though it's repealed, shows itself in other cases, you know, other aspects of cases. Might be a notice provision or a deadline to file that is exactly the same as in another live statute. Mm-hmm. So you might want to point that out. So I would take a little bit of time explaining, here's the provision that creates jurisdiction. Here's why it's important for you to resolve this question today.
Well, when someone listens to this, Chief Justice, it brings up what your rules refer to, that it's obvious how important this petition is. Your rules refer to that you don't need to discuss all possible error that you may assert. And so if a lawyer is sitting there with three or four, what, you know, he or she living this case for probably already 2, 3, maybe even 4 years,
right,
thinks they're all important, are you really saying, should you try to take the one or two most important and really convince you that we should take it and leave the others for the full briefing?
Well, I think the better lawyers limit the issues on appeal to 1, 2, or 3 points, really.
Okay.
And that those are the ones that are discussed. And let me give you a practical reason why I say this, and I was in practice as well, and I had clients that would say, no, you need to, you know, lay out every, and so you have 15 issues to present to the Supreme Court. It's not as important at the Supreme Court. The Court of Appeals, if you don't present the issue, you waive it and it's gone, and they have to address every single one. We are a discretionary court, and so we're not looking for all these minor points. We're looking for a case that has major importance to the jurisprudence of the state. Now, if you come up to our court and in one of these petitions there's there are 15 issues to decide. Remember I was saying that as I'm reading through this petition, I'm projecting a future conference. It will be easier for me, if I'm assigned the opinion, to come up with a majority answer to that case if I'm dealing with 1, 2, or 3 questions. If there are 15, I'm thinking ahead of time, I might get a majority on issue number 1, but on 14, we're going to divide miserably. On 15, there's no hope. It'll be a plurality opinion. And
right. So,
it's just much more complex to get the right answer to that case. And so I recommend, this is not a rule, but I recommend that lawyers limit the issues that they present to the court in the petition for review. And if there are collateral matters that are not so important, but you think you need to preserve them. They might involve $15,000-$20,000, or it might involve the property line somewhere that is not as important as the major issue. Then you can brief those in the brief on the merits. But even on the brief on the merits, it's better to have fewer than a voluminous presentation of issues.
Okay. So your rules allow, or I don't mean your rules, but the appellate rules allow for a reply to the petition. Is there any guidance? I mean, it's not mandatory, but what should a appellee's or potential appellee's approach be when the petition has been filed? Should they respond?
Well, my thinking on this has evolved over time. Before I came to the court, I used to advise my clients that you should respond, file a respondent's brief to the petition. And the reason I advised my clients that way was I was worried that a court or a judge may read the petition and just become invested in it early on, and then try to persuade their colleagues and maybe not even see the respondent's brief if it's not right there before them as they're first reading the petition. Mm-hmm. But I've come to find out that's not, at least it's not the way I look at it. I'll read the petition, and I've been doing this long enough, and so have my colleagues, to know that sometimes the petition might sound good, but there's another side to it that says they waive the argument, or there's not really a conflict among the courts of appeals on this question, or the statute was interpreted just right by the court of appeals. So if I'm interested, I'll mark it for a response and I'll ask for one. We're not going to grant a petition without first, and this is in the rule too, without first requesting a response. Then you can use your time efficiently. This is a case that the court has some interest in, and they've asked for a response, then you can prepare it and not worry that the court has gained, that there's been so much momentum that it's now likely to be granted without having filed a response. So I would wait for the response. Now there are cases that most lawyers would know the court is going to be interested in. It's a clear matter of first impression. The Court of Appeals has directly contradicted another Court of Appeals and asked the Supreme Court to take a look at it. It's a matter of great public concern. You know, there are some that you just have, you kind of know the court is going to want some further briefing on. If you want to accelerate the process, then you would file a response, a respondent's brief right away, just so you can get this case moving along. So if there's a time element to the disposition that you or your client is concerned about, you can accelerate the process by filing the brief early.
So I guess the rules allow a reply to the response.
Yes.
I assume that what you would be saying is that in the normal course, that's not necessary, but in a bigger case, it would be?
Well, a reply to the response, I know that some of my colleagues think it can be critical. What if the response comes and says you waived the error? Completely waived the error, and you hadn't addressed it in the petition, and so you're left with the impression, a judge might be left with the impression that we couldn't even reach this question if we wanted to because it wasn't preserved. Well, maybe a reply needs to come back and say, oh yes, and here is the jury instruction that we submitted, and here's the judge's signature saying it's overruled. That preserves the error under Rule 274 or whatever it is, and so it might be important on some questions, in some cases, to answer the response. So I leave it to the lawyer's judgment on that. If the response makes a good point or one that needs to be answered that wasn't addressed in the petition, then a reply would be recommended.
Okay.
But I wouldn't do a reply just to regurgitate what you've already said in the petition.
And I apologize for going back a little bit, but I was going to ask this question and I dropped it, is that what, even if you don't think your case is of that great importance, but you do believe that the petitioner or appellant has incorrectly stated, they haven't preserved their error, even in a smaller case, should you submit a response at that point? Because, you know, your general advice was that wait to see if the court needs a response. But if there's actually, that you honestly believe that they waived that error and that there is no conflict between the circuits, should we rely that you, the justices, will know that, or should we go ahead and file our response?
I would, I guess I would wait. And in most cases, you save money, save your clients money, you save okay. time, you're busy. I would wait to see if the court requests a response in most cases. In those where you're sure that the court's going to be interested, there have been, I don't know, just a lot of amicus interest in, or it's a matter that is, you know, of primary concern involving a huge issue, then I'd file a response. But only if you want to accelerate the process. You can wait and be comfortable that the court will request a response, and then we'll talk about it at that point.
And what you brought up, are amicus briefs appropriate at the petition stage, or is that something, if at all, that you wait till full briefing if you get that far? Or what is your advice if attorneys were representing a doctor and thought the medical association would want to get involved and think this is a vital issue? Should you highly suggest to them that is an amicus helpful at the petition stage?
Whether an amicus is helpful depends on the content between the covers. If it is an objective assessment, of an issue that maybe is not clearly one of statewide importance, but some association says this is critical. The way this contract is interpreted is going to involve, thousands of contracts that are written daily, and it's a common provision. So we need to get it right. Then I would go ahead and get that amicus brief filed. To my way of thinking, it depends on the quality. Now, if as I'm reading the petition or the response or getting ready for conference, the conference is where all the judges sit around the table and decide the case. If as I'm getting ready, there are amicus briefs in the file, I'm going to read them. I'm going to be curious. What is this group or association or professor or a non-lawyer? What do they say about this case? If it's interest, if they have an interest, I'm going to take it into account as I'm preparing for a discussion with my colleagues. The kind of brief that doesn't work is one that just repeats what the petition said, and that's it. Usually a different perspective, and I recommend one that is somewhat more objective, in the case will come in, because the amicus lawyer is not representing the client, but is helping the court interpret the law and take it, write it from that point of view, not necessarily as an advocate. Some of the best briefs, either petition or amicus, are ones that say this is, we don't know how the court will rule ultimately on this, but the court should take it because it is vital to our industry or vital to harmony and the rules of procedure that the court answer the question so that there's predictability in the law. So that is a good function for the amicus brief.
Okay. So to what degree can you tell us that when you come to conference, with the cases that have shown an interest, what is the deliberative process at that point?
Well, I'll say this first. A judge is more persuasive in conference to the extent he or she has really digested what the case is about. The petition, they know what's in it, they know what the Court of Appeals said, they know the procedural history, but also they might know what is going on in other cases that are similar, if it's a statutory provision. So there's a real benefit to preparation. So I've noticed, on our court, that the judge who's most prepared has some more influence. It's the same thing, in front of a jury or a judge, et cetera. So what should happen is everyone has given their votes, and by the time we get to conference, we've seen it electronically, but we also get a sheet that shows where everyone's vote is. So on a sheet like this, it's a yellow sheet. I didn't bring a copy of that. but you'll know how many have voted to discuss. And maybe there are eight that have voted to discuss. And it tells me, the petitioner's done his or her job. The court is interested. There might be some vote to deny, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
But what happens is I'll call the case from the earlier docket numbers down. And we start at motions for rehearing of petitions. And these are petitions that have been denied, and
right.
Someone will file a motion for rehearing. And we can talk about that later if you would like. But we'll see if anyone wants to discuss the rehearing of the petition. Now, by this stage, if it's a rehearing, we know that it's gone through at least one, well, not necessarily a conference. If it was denied because no one voted to discuss, then that petition has a very heavy burden to get the court to decide to grant. But often it has gone through a conference, and maybe there's even been briefing on the merits before we have denied the petition. And in those instances, the court is already familiar with the arguments. So a motion for rehearing that just repeats the old arguments, we've already heard those and you move along. But if the motion for rehearing states something new, states a consequence of our denial that, we may not have seen, or new, maybe amicus briefs come in at that point and say you should have granted this because, whatever mm-hmm. whatever their advocacy is, then we may talk about, then we'll talk about it at a conference. If it's a rehearing that is at our conference, it's because someone wants to talk about it. So we start with the motions for rehearing, then we go on to the petitions. Now you have to remember, petition A may be child custody, B will be oil and gas, C will be a constitutional free speech question. A third case or fourth case might be insurance dispute. So we're moving pretty rapidly through all of these. And it's impressive to see the court's preparation on these, because you'll go and you'll highlight what's important about the case. If I voted to deny, usually I'll have a reason that I've listed on my in my notes. It's because it's unimportant, the Court of Appeals is right, it's, we should wait until this law develops a little bit. For whatever reason I voted to deny, I'll say it. So I'll call first on the person who wants to talk about it. And Justice Beal, you in 010, 001, you voted to discuss why. And you'll give your reasons. And even at this point, you might not have decided that this case needs to go further, but it might just be that something has caught your eye and you want to discuss it with your colleagues. And you say, I'm likely to deny this, but there is one section of the Court of Appeals opinion that troubles me. It might have, bad consequences if we let it go without, any rejection or mm-hmm. qualification. And then we'll talk about among the court. And you've made your case, and then I may say, I read that too, but I think it's not a problem or what have you. And we'll go around the room, and the court will talk about that petition in that manner. Now, if you are persuaded that we shouldn't deny this outright, that we need to study it further, then you would be a vote for a memo. There's a provision for a study memo. And if you get two colleagues to agree on that, then we will ask for briefing on the merits and assign it to one of our law clerks to analyze even further for
so
us.
So that's when you'll ask the parties to brief on the merits?
Right.
Okay.
And so you'll know at that point that you have at least three judges who think there is enough in this petition that it could be a grant. It could possibly be a grant depending on the scrubbing that our law clerks do on the brief on the merits. So the brief on the merits come, a 50-page document, or
right.
50-page maximum. It doesn't have to be 50 pages if it doesn't merit that.
You knew I was going to ask that later on.
It doesn't have to be, but 50-page maximum, where the record also comes up to the court, and we have, typically it's a first year at a law school student. Mm-hmm. They graduated the year before, and now they're serving 1 year with a justice on the Supreme Court. These are brilliant men and women. They've written on Law Review, they've, top of their class, some of them have, other experiences that are relevant to what we do. They are assigned the task of preparing a memo that will analyze, lay out what the case is about, the procedural history, and then analyze the arguments. The petitioner has these three points, and they'll be summarized in the study memo. The respondent responds this way, and here's my analysis of these two positions. And then the law clerk gives a recommendation. Recommendation isn't followed religiously. We often, we do our own independent study on those.
Right.
But you have, for the next conference, a document along with the petition for review and the briefs on the merits and any portion of the record that you want to look at that you prepare for before you walk into conference. So now there's been real attention given to your case. And the court will again discuss, and we'll have another vote sheet on that petition, whether we want to discuss or deny or grant, whatever we want to do. And so it'll be discussed all over again. It'll be Smith versus Jones. Justice Beal, I know that you would grant this case, but Justice Smith over there would not. And why not? Why do you think it ought to be a grant, and why are you still opposed to a grant? And then again, there's a discussion that goes around the table. And if four votes come to grant that petition, then it'll be granted and set for argument. So that's generally the process. It's dynamic. There's engagement among the judges. I'm sort of leading this symphony of debate on the petition. There occurs occasionally questions about, even after the brief on the merits have come, we're still unclear about a portion of the record or about an argument that's made. And at that point, we might ask one of the law clerks that are sitting around the room to stand up and give us a little fuller account. Was this really in the record? And, what did the contract really say? And does the law, let's say we're looking at other jurisdictions, does Ohio really go that way? What's the count in the jurisdictions? So the person who has prepared that memo may stand up and give us a little more information before we vote.
Okay. So is it fair to say then that if I just want to clarify, because I wasn't aware, and it seems like a great system, that nothing is granted without discussion.
Right.
Is it the most is that, like you say, you can see that eight wanted to talk about it, that probably is a foregone conclusion that there'll probably be enough votes to grant, but it's always discussed at the meeting.
Well, but there have been times when eight or nine vote to grant vote to discuss, and after the discussion, we all vote to deny.
Oh, okay.
I mean, it can be that way. That's unlikely when you have that kind of collection of interest in the case early on, but it just depends. Sometimes we'll vote to discuss just because of the important. The issue is important, but maybe all of us have this lingering feeling that the question hasn't really been presented adequately,
and this is not the case to take that.
Right, or it's important. But it becomes somewhat clear that if we were to grant it, it would only be to affirm what the Court of Appeals did. Well, why? It happens, and we've done that. But in general, a discretionary court like the U.S. Supreme Court or us, the percentages are higher on reversals than grants.
Right.
Because you've already got a result that is good, then do you really need to tinker with it? Maybe you do, to change the opinion somewhat or to... Mm-hmm. Go at it a different way, or only because we think the Supreme Court ought to write on this to make clear to other courts that this is definitely the law. But so it could be an important issue, but maybe not one worthy of a grant. So
okay.
And if just to not to interrupt you, but if there are six people who think the answer to this question presented by the petition is so easy. The Court of Appeals just got it wrong. We decided this very issue the other way, and it wasn't cited in the Court of Appeals opinion. We don't need argument to make that determination. If six of us agree this is so easy that we can issue a per curiam opinion, unsigned, to correct this error, which is very clear, is not complicated, oral argument wouldn't aid the court in deciding the case, then there can be, at that conference, after the briefs on the merits have been done, a vote to issue a per curiam opinion. And then the chambers that out of which the study memo came would be assigned the task of writing a per curiam opinion.
Okay.
And that would come back to the court whenever that draft was completed. And then we'll talk about the opinion at that point. without argument.
Well, I appreciate you bringing that up. I totally did not know that. Mm-hmm. So assuming that we get to the point where you've granted the petition and we're sitting down to write the brief, and I know this has been asked many times, but I think it's good to hear, particularly from the Chief Justice, is that obviously at the front of that brief is the statement of facts. And just how important are the statement of facts in a brief of particularly the petitioner or the appellant?
Well, they can be critical. The one thing that I would like to know as I'm reading these briefs is, are these facts contested? I mean, there are times when the question before us is one of legal sufficiency. Is there mm-hmm. evidence to support the jury's verdict or not and the trial court's judgment? And parties often disagree about that. So I would like to know, I'd like a signal that this, you know, fact was disputed, but you contend that it was conclusively established, or you contend there's no evidence to support it. Whatever your position is on that, it would be nice to know. The other thing about the facts is if there's an error in brief writing, it is that some lawyers go on too long on the okay. facts. They want to give me every single detail. You know, the typical too long version would begin on January 20th, 2003, you know, this happened. And I'm thinking, okay, January 20th must be an important date,
okay.
or else it wouldn't be in here. So as I'm reading the rest of the paragraph or the statement of facts, I'm trying to relate this date to some importance. And quite often there's no link at all. People just like to write chronologically. They like to tell the story that way. Instead, I would get to the very poignant facts. Leave out all of the things that don't matter to the outcome and focus on what is important. And that takes a lot of work. That will make what would have been a 50-page brief, maybe a 25-page. It's more work to get to a 25-page brief than to write 50 pages, but it's worth it. So you make it shorter, you make it interesting. There are headings that tell me where you're going next, so you keep drawing me in from beginning to end. That's the kind of way I think the kind of brief that's most successful. And I'm going to pause a moment and say this. I'm one judge among nine.
Right.
Okay, so I have one vote among nine. So if you talk to other judges, you know, they may have different impressions about mm-hmm. what's important and what's not. I think what I've told you today would be pretty universally felt among my colleagues, but maybe not necessarily 100%.
Well, since you were such a specialist in appellate practice while you were in practice, I mean, is the way to get there is to write the facts and put them aside and come back another day? I mean, is that the way to boil them down, to get them down from, I mean, like, would you say the first time just put in what you think is important and don't worry how long it is, and then come back and see and say, what do I need to do to cut this?
Well, you should try always to write concisely. So, but no one can do that, or at least I can't the first time around. I mean, I often write, whether it's on the law or the facts, there's much editing that needs to take place. So I wouldn't worry about, I mean, you can put it all in at once, but as you're going through, you know, what is important and what's not. And everyone's got their own style on how they work, some with index cards, some with
right.
you know, pieces of the record open around them. That's not as important as the final product. What I would recommend is you think of what are you ultimately asking the court to do? And how does this, you know, factual bit relate to what you're asking the court to do later? Or how does it fit into the analysis? There are many causes of action that have five elements, you know, and if you're the plaintiff and it's your case, or the defense, and it's an affirmative defense
right.
of these elements, you're thinking, what evidence do I have to support these elements? And so you're really, the factual background is intended to be the introduction and a material introduction to the application of those facts to the law. So, you know, the issue is you get those done, you make them concise, you take out all of the fluff, and leave what's important. Write it, if you can, in an interesting way, a gripping way, if the case lends itself to that, but don't use hyperbole. And then make sure that the facts that you've written easily translate into the law that you're advocating the court adopt. And that's sort of philosophical, but I think the more you do that, the better you become at it. For the lawyers out there, I would recommend, we've gone to great lengths in the past, 10 years to become more transparent. So these petitions that I'm reading now, as of February, I think, all the petitions are going to be online. And we're asking the lawyers to send electronic versions as well as filing the paper copies. And the briefs on the merits have been online for some time now.
Right.
So you can become a student of the court and see which petitions are being granted. And in your spare time, I would read those petitions, the briefs on the merits, read them. It's a case of the court granted. There was something within the 50 pages or less of that brief on the merits that persuaded the court to grant. And if you read enough of them like we do, you'll begin to understand what works and what doesn't work. Calling your opponent a liar doesn't work. Exclamation points don't work. The Court of Appeals is corrupt is not helpful. But you can write the facts in a way that I draw my own conclusion on that, that this litigant really was treated unfairly, either procedurally in trial or the jury really went way overboard because the evidence doesn't support it. If you write your brief well enough, then you'll draw me to that conclusion without having to make those pejorative comments.
So if I hear correctly what you're saying, a lawyer really only needs to put in facts that don't go directly to a material issue if in any way it helps with context. And
yes.
If it doesn't, then just trash it.
Right.
Okay.
Right. And I was working on an opinion right before I came over here. And that was my process. Okay, here's a sentence or two in the factual recitation. Why do I need them? And what would happen if they were taken out? And very often, sentences and words, prepositional phrases can come out and it looks better. I mean, the opinion reads better. And it's more direct. It has more punch. So I'd say the same thing to counsel out there is to be brutal. Take the things out that you don't need.
Mm-hmm.
Have someone else read it. I mean, maybe it needs to go back in, but if it comes back in, you have a reason for putting it in there.
Well, the next issue, which I'm sure we can get many opinions, but I know everyone would be valued to hear yours, is that if you've got the four or five issues, and you're getting ready to write that part of the brief, do you go in legal, logical order, or do you go with the issue that you think is the most important when you're writing the brief?
I would say for the petition for a review, you start with the most important.
Okay.
The most important part of the case. The thing that is most wrong about the Court of Appeals opinion, or the one that would disrupt the law the most, bring that front and center.
Okay.
And say, this is what you need to decide. And, it could be an issue, it might be, some matter of summary judgment practice that the Courts of Appeals have split up on. We get thousands of these summary judgment cases, et cetera. So maybe this is one that is really important, not even to your client. Your client doesn't care about summary judgment practice. They want to win.
They want to win.
But this is the most important, this is the thing that will grab the court's attention, so maybe that needs to come up front, or at least be spoken about early on, and then move on to the other things that matter. So particularly when you're trying to get the court's attention and get them to not throw the petition in the trash bin, put it front and center.
Okay.
You're not going to waive other arguments by doing it that way, so I would certainly recommend that.
But in the brief on the merits, maybe a different approach?
Maybe. Maybe more chronological. You know that the court's got the attention, the court has accepted your contention that the issue is important, or at least three judges have, not necessarily the entire court, but at least three. You may need to go be a little more methodical about it and tell the whole story. There are some issues that can still wait to the end, but
right.
But maybe it makes sense to, I don't know, that's kind of a matter of appellate advocacy. What is the most persuasive. If I'm having to jump from point, you know, K to A, then back to C, and it's all disjointed, I might, as a judge reading this, become confused about what you're really saying. So you want to make sure that you bring the court along. And sometimes chronologically be the best way. Sometimes importance is the better factor. But I think you know if you write well, you'll figure it out.
Okay. A particular area which is much of the law that you deal with, and that's statutes. Mm-hmm. Have you found in your time on the court, I guess particularly when you're dealing with a complex statute, and you know we've gone to codes today, so statutes can be humongous in length.
Right.
That are lawyers doing a good job in the brief to really let you understand what the statute says, or do you find yourself often, either you or your law clerk, running to get the actual statute because you can't understand what they're saying?
Well, if the statute is what we're construing.
Mm-hmm. And I meant to say,
yes,
that's the issue. What is the meaning of
that? An omission may be where lawyers take until the 15th page to quote the statute.
Okay.
They might talk about the Court of Appeals doing all these things to the statute, but there's no one place where you can see it. So it either needs to be in the appendix so that we can refer to it directly. Same thing with a contract. You know, if you're talking about a contractual provision, mm-hmm. give us the language and tell us why the language supports the outcome that you favor. So I would early on identify what the statute is, quote it, put it in the appendix, and then go about saying what it means or what it should mean. So lawyers, you know, most lawyers are pretty good at that, but not all. And if they don't do the work, then we'll have to. It's frustrating, but it doesn't defeat your case. But it just shows a lack of knowledge about what the court does. You want to make it as easy as you can for the judge to give you the relief that you want. And to make it easy, you need to lay it out early on.
Okay. And as we all know, because your court uses them, but I guess I always have, and this comes up actually in law school, that we have the canons of construction that the courts have developed on their own, and then we even have the statutory canons in chapter, I think, 311 and 312 of the government code. Is it really important that when you are making your arguments that you cite and acknowledge that you're using a canon? You know, I've heard both ways that, no, that can break the flow of your argument, or, you know, if you're using, I guess, a Husdom Heneris, should you say that, identify it, cite a case?
I'm glad you pronounced that, because I never knew how it was pronounced. I would say very often those canons are embodied in our precedent.
Right.
You know, so a case may have used it and said it applies, or the court relies on this canon in interpreting the statute. And if that's the case, then I think definitely you need to lay it out there, because we're unlikely to change our the stare decisis, you know,
right.
our point of view on that case. And it happens, but not always. So I would lay it out. But it's kind of like a different topic, but a summary judgment case.
Mm-hmm.
You'll get four pages of Nixon versus Mr. Property and all these, you know, McConnell and all these pages of standard of review on summary judgment, et cetera. Well, we've seen it enough times that, you know, a footnote, a reference to it would be fine.
Okay.
And that's the same with canons of construction. There are some that are, you know, so easily recalled that a citation might be enough, and then you get to your argument about how your case fits within that canon one way or the other. And the other thing to know is that we're sophisticated about these canons, because you can find canons to do almost anything.
Right.
You know, I mean, the canons contradict each other at times, and
no hierarchy.
Right. It's hard to know. So you need to put it in the context of why you should win. A canon supports it. Tell us if there's a canon that doesn't support it. You know, there's another canon that goes the other way, but it's not one that ought to be applied in this case for these reasons. Maybe the court has frowned on it in the past. Maybe in this context it doesn't apply because the list of factors that are in the statute are purely advisory, and you can tell that because, you know, the bill analysis or legislative history or the way courts have interpreted it over the years or what have you. So it's helpful to know if you're using a canon or if you're rejecting some other canon and tell us why. But then quickly get to the heart of the matter. I mean, that's what we're not machines. We're not just going to always apply this canon and that means this outcome no matter what. If it means a child dies, you know, in South Texas, you know, well, maybe that means the canon wasn't, you know, properly adopted
or meant
in the first
to be
place.
Used there.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, one that comes up and causes debate, and I don't know how much, I mean, I guess this will bring the professor out of me, that Justice Scalia has kind of waged a war for a number of years of he has a belief that legislative history, committee reports, statements of persons on the floor, that he wants to totally disregard them. And I can't help but with the opportunity with you here today is that, what is your view on the use of that type of legislative history?
Well, I've read his matter of interpretation. Mm-hmm. I've read and seen the dialogue between he and Justice Breyer. On the subject, and I find it very interesting every time I return to that subject. But I can tell you generally, I'll tell you kind of generally what I think, and then I'll leave the rest to lawyers and scholars to look at the opinions that I've written. But generally, I think it's the words that matter. And that would be a Scalia point of view. It's the text we're interpreting. Now, there might be all kinds of legislative views on what that text meant or what they intended, et cetera, but if the text says, you know, this color is black, well, you know, that's pretty easy to interpret, and that's generally how we'll interpret it. Now, having said that, I'm always curious about the context in which legislation was adopted. I've seen since I've been on the court two statutes, maybe in the same code provision, that are diametrically opposed. You know, there's one, and maybe both were unanimously adopted. You know, and the court is going to have to decide which one prevails. And it might be interesting for me to know what was happening in the legislature at that time, how much consideration was given. Is this something that was really at the front and center of their deliberations or not? And then what are the consequences of applying it this way and that way? There might be a legislative record that says what the consequences are, with a lot of testimony before various committees. Well, I'm going to be curious about that, and I would never strike a brief for, you know, giving me that sort of history and context that would aid in our decision making. But I would say that there are others, judges that I've worked with, former, you know, judges and current, that would say no, none of that is relevant. You'll get occasionally letters or briefs from legislators who were there at the time, and I think and they might say, yes, that's what we wrote, but that's not what we meant. Well, you know, what you wrote is what
the law is.
Yeah, what the law is, what citizens are turning to in order to conduct their affairs, what judges are applying to resolve disputes. So it's more, by far, it's more important what is said than the context. But for me, the context is important. It's interesting and occasionally can make the determination on how the case comes out.
Well, I would at least personally call modern phenomenon, and I've never seen your court directly rely on it, but I've seen more often lawyers getting the sponsor to write a letter as to the court, almost like an amicus letter of not saying that we wrote it wrong, but this is exactly what we meant by those words. And, you know, it's really post hoc after the bill's been adopted. And is that really of any worth for lawyers to be profiting, you know, because these aren't committee reports that were adopted at the time by the committee, but are these current statements of a sponsor of a bill that is now a statute?
Well, I won't comment on whether they should be filed or not, but I will say, you know, the court reads, you know, what is submitted, So we may know this sponsor thinks that that's what the law meant. There are whole law review articles that are written by sponsors of bills,
right?
Some of which are very helpful. You know, that these were the currents of thought that were debated on the House floor when this was adopted. Here's who testified as to what, and that's what led to this provision being adopted. You know, that's kind of interesting, as I say, historical mm-hmm. work. But at the end of the day, the question is, what do these words mean? And I think it's happened before where a sponsor will say, this was the intent, this is what I meant, but the words go the other way. And then I think it's our job to apply the law as written. And then the legislature can come back, if they wish, and write the statute differently so that it comports with some understanding of the current legislature that may be at odds with our interpretation. And that's happened. And, you know, people will kind of suspect that that's a rejection of the court, or the court's going to be, you know, you got slapped down by the legislature. My view is, no, that's how the process is supposed to work. We interpret it. We're the only ones who can. The legislature doesn't interpret their own work. The founders were very wise in dividing government in these branches so that there are, you know, there are competing interests, et cetera. There are times when the legislature may think that's not good policy. It's a matter of statute, and we'll change the policy to adopt this new area. And they're certainly free to do so.
Okay. Along that line, and somewhat akin, you know, a number of lawyers watching this may be administrative lawyers, we have rules of agencies. And I have noticed, and here's the law professor coming out in me lately, is that your court lately, when you're struggling with, because guess what, agencies can be as ambiguous as a legislature, that you seem to be looking more recently for aid in what was the agency intent in light of the legislative intent, that you're looking at in the second notice when they adopt the rule, that they set forth a reason justification for their rule. And it seems like recently, and I may be wrong, that your court more so is looking to that to try to understand where the agency is coming from. Is that a fair characterization?
It might be fair, but often, we're led that way by the lawyers,
by
the briefing. You know, the briefing will say the rule is exactly right and it comports precisely with legislative intent, and here's how it's all connected. Or it might say this agency has gone rogue. You know, the legislative intent is completely different from this rule that's adopted, and they are in effect becoming a legislature. They are changing policy, and that shouldn't happen. But the lawyers will make these arguments, and then often those arguments will wind up in an opinion as we're considering what to do with the case. And I think I'll leave it at that level of generality, okay, because it'll, you know, there's different precedent on different agencies,
right,
that may come into play.
Okay. Well, to tie back to what we were talking about when we were looking at the petition, now that we have the petitioner has gotten your interest and you've accepted full briefing and you're going to decide the case, is there now a place for amicus briefs? Because it seems like that they can help tell the court this really is important, but now that you've accepted that it's important and you're going to decide the case, are they beneficial at this stage? I mean, along with when there's going to be a full briefing that they should be submitted, is there something they can add?
I think they can. I think not only agencies, associations, there are times when a professor will write a two-page letter that says the Court of Appeals got it wrong and it's important to correct this now for these reasons. And it's a very well-written legal letter, you know, that says why. It doesn't necessarily take a lot of time, but the professor's been engaged in this process, sat on national boards or national associations, knows, you know, what the current thinking is, and that can be very helpful. And same thing with agencies and associations, yes. Now, let me, you talked about the petitions and the briefs. One thing that I would say for agency, for administrative lawyers, mm-hmm. The court, unlike the Third Court of Appeals, they have a good diet of this coming all the time.
Correct.
We don't accept all, you know, they may not reach us because they may settle along the way, or we don't get them as often. The volume is not as great for appeals on administrative law matters, which then recommends to the lawyer not to assume that we know all the terms of art. I mean, I'd like to see a glossary. You know, there are some very, you know, what is it? Before I came onto the court, I never dealt in this. What is a true up? Right. Never heard of that before. I mean, it wasn't part of my practice, and right. I need a little context on that. What is ERCOT, for example? I mean, look and define the terms somewhere, either early on in the brief, give it a little bit of context, or as a glossary. And remember, I'm reading these, but so are law clerks that may not have dealt in these matters. So it may be even more important in an administrative matter to sort of step back away from, you've been living with this case all your life, step back for a little bit and give the bigger picture. It might be in the summary of the argument or in a few introductory pages until you get to the rule that, you know, you're asking us to construe. Step back a little bit, give us a larger context so that we really understand what's going on.
Okay, so the first time you saw a SOA ALJ's PFD, you kind of...
Right, exactly. But now I know all those terms. I feel proud that I've come this far.
And you're doing an excellent job, Chief Justice. As to the response brief, is a response supposed to be a response, meaning directly responding to the issue set forth in the petitioner's brief, or, and I've heard this debated, that, well, of course we have to address their issues, but it should be from the get-go really a statement of what our answer is to that. Is it a weakness to say, yeah, they said that, but. Mm-hmm. Is there any reaction on your part to that?
Not a lot. It'll depend on the case. Point, counterpoint makes sense to me in many cases, but that's just, you know, maybe it's the way my mind works. There are these 3 points in the petition. The response covers those 3 points. I can kind of look at them, you know, side by side and come up with my own determination. It's the process that the law clerks do when they're going through the study memos. You know, petitioner makes this argument, respondent says this as a counter, and here's how I analyze the arguments. So that is sort of logically how the process works at the court. But there may be cases where you want to come up with a response that's really not directly responsive to a point in the petition, and it could be for the reason that we don't take the brief at all, or take the case at all. You know, it mm-hmm. might be, that may be what you start off with. But It's hard to generalize on that. It'll depend on the case. I would say in most instances, we're dealing with 3 or 4 issues. I've read the petitioner's brief in that order, and it would be easier for me to read the respondent's brief in that order.
So what I hear you're saying is that unless you have a really, really good reason, direct response is the best.
I think so, but I don't know what my colleagues think on that, and you'd have to ask them.
And then we come to the potential for a reply brief. And I have heard arguments all the way that if you read the respondent's brief and it, quote, doesn't do damage to what you asserted in your petitioner's brief, that it's better, because the court reads so much, not to submit a reply brief. Where I've heard the total opposite, that's kind of the creme de creme, because you are allowed to hear or read the direct response of the petitioner to the respondent's position.
I would err on the side of responding, again, because these are being read by law clerks, and they're using these briefs to come up with the memo that they submit to the court with their recommendation. So petitioner says this, here's the response. So I'd make that point in the respondent's brief. And then in a reply brief, if there's something that has been left out or miscommunicated by the respondent in its brief, then I would point that out in a reply. The reply should be a very few pages if one is needed at all. So I would keep it pretty simple and just respond. Now, during this whole process, what impresses me is when I see a respondent's brief or the petition say, you know, the other side is completely right on this point. We don't disagree. You know, yes, the case does stand for that proposition, but in this context, you know, you go off in a different way.
Right.
I mean, there's a level of collegiality that really breeds credibility, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You're willing to accept that there are some weak aspects of your case. You may tell us that the rule you're advocating is a harsh rule, but it's important for judgment finality. You know, it's a statute of limitations type case. I mean, you know, you agree, yes, this is unfortunate result, but it's what the statute requires. And if there needs to be a change, they need to go to the legislature to change it. Meanwhile, we've all been relying on these words that they say what they mean, that they mean what they say. So some level of agreement, some understanding that you're not perfect, your case isn't perfect, and yes, maybe you should have objected earlier, but you know, you preserved it this way. That sort of thing is, I think, impressive to me.
So the worst thing to do in a reply brief is to just simply regurgitate what you said in your main brief.
Yes. Yes, it's a waste of time.
Directly respond and admit what you can admit, but then clearly disagree.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's a waste of, you know, if you've said it before, you know, I don't need a brief that reiterates what's already been said. You know, the best advocacy is to put together your first brief as well as you can. Say it as succinctly but powerfully, and then you won't need to file. You may not need to file a reply brief to the response.
Okay. So you've made it clear that in your 50-page maximum, in your initial thrust, if you don't need it, don't use it, and that's absolutely true on the reply. Is that correct?
That's correct, yes.
Okay. Well, if we could now turn to oral argument, and I know you're only speaking for yourself, but where are you when you come to the oral argument? Have you... and if you can't answer that, that's fine too. Have you come to a preliminary position as to, after reading the briefs and your discussions during the petition process, of where you are, and are you there to test your belief, or do you think you're still in somewhat of a neutral position?
Yes, I go back, and you remember we're dealing with hundreds of cases mm-hmm. at a time, and so I'm going to go back and prepare. Usually about the week before argument, bring all the briefs out and the memos again, my notes. I want to know where the court is on this case. So I might, it might be clear to me that there are two camps. The court is split 4-4 and there's some judge in the middle who's not quite sure. I would like to know that before I walk into oral argument. So because I'm, again, planning ahead of time on what the opinion's going to say and how it's going to be written. So I go back and read the briefs again. I read the study memo. I look at my notes, and if I've done and I've written up myself questions that I have maybe about the record or the law that maybe counsel can answer for me. But in the back of my mind, I also have questions I'm going to ask the counsel. I know the answer to, but it's because I want to persuade my colleague, you know, who seemed to be on the fence during all these conferences we had.
Right.
That she needs to come my way on this. I mean, listen to how the counsel answered that or couldn't answer that question. So that might be one of the questions that I do in preparation. But yes, I usually have a preliminary view of the case, and I think most judges do when they walk into oral argument, because we've talked about it enough with our colleagues, with our law clerks. We may have written during this process, there may be memos that have gone back and forth about how important the case is or how wrong the Court of Appeals got it. So I may know some judge thinks that this Court of Appeals is exactly off base. So I, you know, we come into the court with that knowledge, and have a preliminary, I'd say in most cases, a preliminary idea of which way the case is going to come out, or which way we would think the case ought to come out.
So if that is true, and as you know, because you have so many cases, you can only have so long of an oral argument, which is relatively short. Should a counsel spend, as particularly the petitioner, when it comes to facts and statement of facts at that point, are they really important is it a grave mistake to not do anything but remind you that this is what this case is?
I would, again, as I said about going back and reading the briefs that were granted, I would watch our arguments since March of 2007. They're all on the web. They're televised, or they're, you can watch them live on the computer through the internet. I would go back and watch as many arguments as you can, and then you can be as good as I am about evaluating what works and what doesn't work in an oral argument. I mean, it's clear. There are some judges, I mean, lawyers that will start off with, you know, a joke that's hard to follow, you know. Well, we're not here for jokes. And,
right.
And some people are naturally funny, and it's good. You incorporate that in the argument, and that's good.
Right.
Others are not. Know what kind of person you are. You know, to thine own self be true. I mean,
right.
That's the number one, I think, advice. And then what facts are important? There might, you know, you can rest assured that the court knows the case. We've got, you know, we've written the facts for our own. I may have taken notes about the case that highlight the important facts, or law clerks have analyzed it and laid out what facts they believe are important. Both parties have as well. So you might get to the, what are the important ones? Your Honor, there are three facts that ought to be in your mind as you decide this case. These are the three critical facts. I mean, you know the context, but no witness ever testified that Mr. Jones was present when the thing happened. I mean, that is clear. They don't dispute it, that's clear. You know, and that's important to this element of the proof. You know, I mean, you can lay out what is important and put it in context, but you don't need to go from the very beginning.
So it really is a fatal mistake to presume that the court, you know, you hear that all the time, oh, the court doesn't read the documents ahead. I mean, the briefs ahead. They really don't know what they're talking about, but you really do.
Well, it's not a fatal mistake, because if you bore us and you're going from, you know, the founding of Texas, you know, forward, we'll stop you and say, counsel, okay, fine. Now,
okay.
What about, you know, this? And
right.
So it's just not effective is the way I'd put it. The court is pretty, they're not shy about focusing the counsel on what's important, at least to that judge who's asking the question.
And are we, when we get to orals, are we basically back to the petition? Do you most definitely start with what you believe is the most important issue, even if you might argue that logically two other arguments should be made first?
That's going to depend on the court's personality that morning. I think you would want to start with what's most important, because you know your time may run out. So what's most important to you or and your client that needs to be put out on the table? And one of the things you're doing as a lawyer, you're not, at least my view is, you're not lecturing to us. That, you know, that's not good. Now, you can lay it out in a way that, oh, this, you know, finally, you know, I've read, eyes of the judge, I've read these briefs and petitions, but now counsel is putting this in a way that makes me understand it much better. I don't want to interrupt counsel if he or she is doing that. I'm going to take a few notes and think about what you're saying. But if you're not doing that, and you're not, you know, you're not just capturing my attention right away, then I'm going to go straight to the questions that I have. I've laid out, I've got five questions. Maybe you answered the first two in your opening comments. Maybe you didn't answer number three, and I'm going to counsel, you know, your brief says this, but I thought the record said exactly, you know, or something different. Can you explain the divergence between the two, and we'll get you focused on what's interested, what we're interested in, and that's where I think the lawyer's opportunity is. You don't want to lecture. What you're curious about is, where have you not persuaded the court? What questions remain? And the judge may ask a very fundamental question, maybe even a dumb question, you know, but one that lets you answer it in a way that advances your client's case. No, Your Honor, that's not the case, and here's why, and you put it in context. And maybe you've answered that once and for all for the judge, and if you hadn't had an opportunity to talk outside of the briefs, you would never have known that that judge is curious about the fact or that law or the history of that statute or what have you. The other thing that's occurring during conference is I'm listening to my colleagues, and again, with a view toward a final work product, our opinion. A judge on my right or my left may ask a question that even though we've talked about this numerous times, during their preparation, they came up with a question that I had never thought of before that may be outcome determinative. And I'm listening. And if the case is mine to write, I want to make sure I answer that question. So I'm listening as closely to the questions and the comments of my colleagues as I am to the lawyer who's arguing.
So it's fair to say that the worst thing that a lawyer could do is assume that a question asked by the court is not important.
That's probably the worst thing, yes. And the other worst thing they can do is say, Your Honor, that's not my case, and I haven't thought about that because that hypothetical just doesn't fit these facts. And the answer from the judge is, I know the hypothetical doesn't fit the facts. That's why we're asking it, because this case could have implications beyond the two parties involved in this insular case. It could have a dramatic effect on our neighbors, and Texas as a whole, or the oil and gas industry, or the way that we consume water, or who owns it, it might have much bigger impact, and we're trying to write not just for your case, but to establish the law for the state.
Okay. How important is the reply? I mean, it sounds to me, and tell me if I'm wrong, that keeping your time to answer the questions the judge has would counter against keeping too much time for your reply. Is that true? I mean, do you find replies generally beneficial or not?
I think replies are beneficial. Quite often, the petitioner will speak, then the respondent, and then the petitioner will come back up. Mm-hmm. And as they're approaching the podium, the judge will ask a question, because we know the time is limited in reply.
Okay.
And something the respondent said really got us thinking that maybe your first argument wasn't that strong. So you need to, if you're the petitioner and you're waiting for the respondent to be finished, you need to listen to the questions and to the answers. Sometimes it's a question about the record citation. And the respondent doesn't know the answer, it might be good for you to go up, especially if it's material. Mr. Chief Justice, here's the answer to that question. It's at volume 7, page 323, and the witness said X. And, good. I've got that down. My question's finally answered. You get a little credit because you knew the answer and your opponent didn't. But you listen and decide for yourself what became the important theme in the case, and make sure you're going to have the last word. Make sure it's an effective last word.
Okay. And one thing that I probably should have asked a little sooner, what if you really do get hit with a question from the justice that you honestly don't know the answer to? Is it appropriate to volunteer that you can post-argument brief that? Is that the time to do that in the oral argument? That they're honestly, you saw right. Something they didn't see.
Right. The first answer I have for that is, you, in your preparation, you do everything you possibly can to know the answer to every conceivable question. We're human beings, we don't always get there, but you do everything you can to have an answer. Even if you're not the one who tried the case or went through the administrative proceeding, you have read the record from top to bottom, you know the answer to that, and you're prepared to give it. Or if it's a question about the industry, it's not in the record. Sometimes we'll ask a question about the industry. I mean, don't just be confined to your briefs and the record. There are times that we'll say, is this standard? And you can tell us, Your Honor, this isn't in the record, but my understanding is, maybe it's from a treatise, or maybe there's another source of law that you can point to answer that question. So you try to, you want to, it's not, you're not a failure if you can't answer every question, but your preparation is to avoid giving the I don't know answer. But third, if you don't know the answer, it is very impressive to say, Your Honor, I simply don't know the answer to that question. I think it's a great question. I think it could be relevant to this case in these respects. Can I submit a post-submission letter brief or brief to answer it? And since I've been on the court, we've never said no to a request like that. So I think it's fine to ask.
Okay. So the argument is over, and the court, now you get to the Waterloo. You have to decide the case. To what degree can you tell us as to what is the method to making that decision?
I can tell you, we take a recess between each argument. Okay. And so, just so you know, very often in the robing room where we put on our robes before argument, that's the where we go when in between arguments, a judge will say, can you believe whatever, you know, mm-hmm. the lawyer said this, or I didn't know this about the case. And you know, so there's an informal discussion, and don't tell my colleagues, but very often I'll take my pen out and I'm writing notes. I'm listening to what they say.
Yeah.
Because again, I'm you know, trying to, there's an end game to all this.
Mm-hmm.
And so if there's a judge who says, I just didn't know this, or this, that changed my mind. I want to know that it changed his mind or her mind. And so I can be, especially if I'm the author, be ready to answer that doubt or that question. So some of this goes on informally in the hallways, in the robing room, et cetera. But the process is, before the argument, we draw randomly for the case. It's not like the U.S. Supreme Court, where the Chief Justice or the Senior Justice, who's in the majority, assigns the case to be written. We randomly draw it. So I don't know before I draw if I'm going to get an oil and gas case or family law or what. When I walk into the argument, and that'll be about 2 weeks to a month before the argument that I'll know it's my case. And so when I walk into the argument, I know it's my case. And the lawyers don't know, and it's not broadcast anywhere, but we know. And from that point forward, it's my job to persuade at least four of my colleagues, I hope eight of them, that the outcome ought to be this way with this analysis along the way. So I'm at least trying to get four of my colleagues to agree, and so I'm listening to what they're saying. And if I can adopt some point that they're making and put it in the opinion, and it doesn't disrupt the logic or the principle that I'm aiming for, then I'll put it in there. So after argument, there's these informal discussions. I know it's my case, but there are also other cases that have been argued. The judges will, not 100% in all cases, but in most of them, will write post-submission memos to the court. They're usually a page, 2 pages long, sometimes 4 or 5, but usually about a page or two long, that says, here's my evaluation of how this case ought to come out. And it's 5 points, and here's why. You know, if we went the other way, it'd cause, you know, chaos, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And those will be circulated to the other judges before conference, before the next time we meet for conference. On Monday, we have a conference coming up, on Monday. That's the 4th, maybe, April 4th.
Mm-hmm.
And I will start the conference off with post-submission matters. We heard arguments at St. Mary's last week. Memos are circulating as we speak about how those cases ought to come out from the author, the presumptive author, and other members of the court. Everyone will have a collection of these memos before we walk into conference. And I'll say, Justice Beal, this is your case. You go first. How do you evaluate the case? And you'll say briefly, because we're like the lawyers, like my recommendation to the lawyers, I don't need a recitation of all the facts.
Right.
We just heard argument about it. So you'll say, this is a case you'll recall involving the slip and fall at, you know, the grocery store. Here's how I think it ought to come out. Trial court did this, court of appeals did this. I think we should reverse and render, affirm for these reasons. Thank you very much. And then I'll go around the table and see if everyone else has an opinion on it. They may be in the memos, or they may state
right.
it orally. And again, I'm taking notes to see where people fall down. And some are very emphatic. It needs to be affirmed. I'm completely the other way. Others are, I'll remain open. I'm not sure. It depends on how it's written. I may be with you, but I have these concerns. 1, 2, and 3, these concerns, these things are concerning me. So I hope you'll address them in your opinion, Justice Beal. I hope you will. And if you don't, I may have to write myself. And then another one may say, I'm with you 100%. Another one may say, I think I'm likely to dissent. So by the end of that, you know, round table, you know where the case stands. Now, let's say you only got one other judge to go along with you. you're clearly in the minority. It's going to be a dissent. Then it makes sense for us to assign another judge to write the majority opinion on that case. And usually I will make a recommendation. Again, everything works, you know, you get to five and that's how everything is decided.
Right.
But my recommendation will be based on who's current and who's maybe most interested in the case and that sort of thing. And I'll say, you know, Justice X, would you take on the majority? And they'll say yes, or I thought, you know, maybe another, my colleague ought to take it. I mean, so that'll get resolved at the post-submission conference. And it's, again, a very dynamic process, very interesting to see occur. There are occasions when you may only have four votes altogether for your position. But you'll ask me, Chief, I think I might be able to bring another one on board. Can you, and this is in open court, open conference, let me take a shot. I think maybe I can answer these concerns. And unless there's real opposition, we'll give that judge that opportunity. It may still wind up a dissent, but very often they'll bring enough people on board to make it a majority. And then from that point, the judges go back and work on the opinions. Some judges do it completely themselves from start to finish. And they use the law clerks for research. Each judge has two law clerks and one permanent staff attorney. Some judges assign it to the staff attorney. Some assign it to law clerks with supervision by the staff attorney before it comes to the judge as a draft. Mm-hmm. But in every instance, the judge will communicate in outline form or with the post-submission memo or with a lengthy discussion, communicate to the staff in their chambers how they think the case ought to come out and why. And then it's a process, it differs from chambers to chambers, an ongoing discussion among that chambers about how that draft ought to come out. And then you finally get to a point where it's written, and then you circulate it electronically and by paper copy to each of the chambers and staff attorneys, and then it is set for the following conference to discuss.
So it's orally discussed again when you get to what you think is your final draft.
Right.
Okay.
And I'll say, Justice Beal, you know, you've written this opinion. Take it away. And you might start saying, as you'll recall, in my post-submission memo and conference, I thought the case can